Jimmy Savile never fails to intrigue me. Don't get me wrong, I think he is one of the biggest pieces of human excrement to ever walk the face of this earth. He is absolutely vile, absolutely savile. But it has to be said, there's a lot about him that is just so fascinating. A series of paradoxes, contradictions, and just plain oddness wrapped up in one disgusting little package. I am reviewing the book In Plain Sight by Dan Davies. The book not only delves into Savile's crimes, but also his life. This is no surprise given Dan Davies is a journalist by trade, and at the time of writing the book, he was actually writing a biography about Savile prior to his death. And he was trying to lift off that big, heavy mask he wore. Even after Savile's death in 2011, Dan Davies still had unanswered questions. We all did. The book does not in any way feel unfinished, but like Savile's life, it ends in ambiguity, leaving us with more questions than answers. We all knew he was acquainted with Charles and Diana, and how he made strange bedfellows with Thatcher and Blair. What I didn't know was just how far his kraken-like tentacles reached. He was associated with gangsters like Bill Benny in his 1960s clubland days. On the other end of the spectrum, he would have tea and biscuits with senior police chiefs. He called this the Friday Morning Club. It seems like a contradiction, associating with people from opposite ends of society and even political spectrums. Yet, Savile was drawn to power, and he would latch on to anyone who could offer him protection and immunity. It is unclear what is reality and what is fiction with Savile. A significant portion of his self-written history consists of a series of boasts, devoid of any hint of humility or weakness. The exact amount of money he raised for charity, was it 30 million, 40 million, or perhaps less? Additionally, he boasted about his achievements in cycling and marathon running, despite having suffered spinal injuries after a coal mine collapse. When asked about the chronology of events and specific dates relating to his Bevin Boy days, he replied to Dan Davies, "How the fuck should I know? 1642. Dan Davies beautifully describes this as, "It was a tactic he employed often, obfuscation occasionally coupled with menace that erected a dead end for channels of inquiry he didn't much care for." Jimmy Savile met a lot of famous people, and a little bit of him seemed to rub off on them. Rolf Harris, who infamously drew a caricature of Savile using his trademark thick black marker pen. He also drew another one that was reportedly of Savile as a hound dog, both sold at auction in 2012. Harris sexually assaulted several women and underage girls. Another shady figure is Peter Giaconelli, the ice cream king of Scarborough. He was a lifelong friend of Savile's and was said to be his gay lover. Giaconelli sexually assaulted young boys and opened a judo school, which allowed him easy access to his victims. As pointed out in Plain Sight, despite his huge girth and waddling gait, claimed to be a black belt, boys that attended the club said he wasn't anything of the sort. There's also rumours he ran a pedo ring. He died in 1999 without facing prosecution. Another despicable human Savile met several times is Peter Sutcliffe. Savile described him as good as gold and ordinary. There's also police files showing that Savile was even suspected of being the Yorkie Ripper due to his association with prostitutes in Leeds and the discovery of the body of murdered prostitute Irene Richardson near the Roundhay flat where Savile had recently moved in. Jimmy Savile studied psychopaths and killers because he wanted to understand more about himself. Such knowledge would ensure he'd never end up in the same predicament. We also have to mention that famous, or should I say infamous, Frank Bruno photo. Bruno visited Savile at Broadmoor when his boxing career was on the ropes in 1991. Savile served as a sort of mentor to Frank Bruno. Could there be a more unlikely pairing? Savile introduced Bruno to Sutcliffe and an unexpected photograph captured the moment for us all to see. In Bruno's words, "I was in Broadmoor to open a gym, not to meet the man who killed 13 women. Savile planned it. It was not a nice thing to do to me. If I'd known it was the Ripper, I'd have tried to get out of it. It was a scary feeling." A lot of people said Bruno looked scared in the picture. I think he looks confused. It's intriguing, the hold Savile had over powerful people. Bruno was a heavyweight champion boxer and had a punch like a sledgehammer. Compare and contrast to Savile, who looks like a light breeze would knock him down flat. There are also figures like Gary Glitter, whom Savile interviewed on Clunk Click, and there's several girls from Duncroft School in the audience. It makes for creepy viewing. Ray Terrett, a radio DJ and friend of Savile, was a convicted paedophile. Dave Lee Travis and Max Clifford both posthumously revealed that they knew about Savile's sexual abuse, yet they were convicted under Operation Yew Tree for their own cases of sexual assault. A bit hypocritical, lads. It makes you wonder who else is involved. Jimmy Savile was interviewed by police in 2009 under Operation Ornament. Mistakes were made from the start. Savile delayed the interview by several months, failing to respond to police calls and letters or set a date. Savile was interviewed under caution at Stoke Mandeville Hospital instead of a police station for reasons that are beyond everybody's comprehension. The way the interview was arranged was Savile-led rather than police-led. The interview was a complete and utter shit show, with the police kissing his bony ass and thanking him for his kindness in seeing them. I wonder if poor Gad got the same niceties. He denied everything, of course. He was never pressed on allegations beyond the original questions and was allowed to rattle off a string of boasts and even make thinly veiled threats, including that he sued 5 newspapers. One of the key points raised by Dan Davies is that none of the women who came forward with allegations had the opportunity to meet each other at the time. This lack of interaction prevented them from corroborating their evidence, but more importantly, it deprived them of the support and the reassurance that they were not alone in their suffering at the hands of this absolute fucking monster. Throughout the book, it becomes evident that Jimmy Savile's modus operandi repeats itself. He would isolate girls in TV rooms, his car, or his motorhome, which conveniently had a bed in the back. Additionally, he would woo the girls' parents through meals and sweet talk, grooming girls he finds attractive for his TV programs, and deliberately targeting the vulnerable, the naive, and the starstruck. The real letdown is to the general public and the victims. The police had a real chance at nailing this bastard, but they approached the situation as if he had been caught shoplifting protein bars from Holland and Barrett. As his fame and currency diminished, Jimmy Savile gradually retreated into a lonely netherworld of conjecture and ridicule, a fading figure with no place in nor love for the modern world, and onto which a nation could project its mockery and fear. In his later days, he had an embarrassing appearance on Celebrity Big Brother. He came out in defense of Michael Barrymore and had a cameo on his TV drama Bob Martin. He made some weird but memorable appearances on shows like Have I Got News For You, Meet Ricky Gervais, and the forgotten game show Public Opinion. And of course, who could forget the comic relief single Is This A Way To Amarillo? Comedian Peter Kay accurately described Savile as a dirty shithouse, and he was edited out of future broadcasts. You could clearly see his star fading in the 2000s, while he remained popular with the public. Unlike other elder statesmen like Ronnie Corbett, Mike Reed, and Noel Edmonds, who could reinvent themselves for younger audiences, Savile seemed locked into a nostalgia revival loop where he kept putting out the same shit over and over and once again. Dan Davies portrays him as a tragic figure, and it's difficult not to agree. He clings to past glories, puffing on cigars while spouting off creepy and corny one-liners, which Dan Davies aptly describes as like Tourette's of the soul. The book is beautifully written, making it a must-read for anyone intrigued by his life and lies. In the 1950s, he purchased an old Bentley saloon and affixed a Rolls-Royce radiator grill and hubcaps that he bought from a scrapyard. This seems like a fitting metaphor for the man himself, a piece of junk adorned with a prestigious badge.
We like to believe that there was a darker side, and we like to believe that this was a necessary counterbalance to all his good work for charity that he endlessly told us about and endlessly showed us doing. We like to believe that he went with girls, men, boys, goldfish, dogs, and yet I think overall you have to view him, I think, as genuine in his superficiality.
Now then, I have a letter here. It says, "Dear Sir Jimmy, OBE, congratulations on your knighthood, you see. How do you wish to be addressed? Will it be Sir Jim, Sir Jimmy, Sir James, or just you sad man?"